And now, since I know you're all eager, we are fortunate to have here this evening Scott Draves, who is the creator of the Electric Sheep Project and the inventor of the flame algorithm, to introduce tonight's speaker. Enjoy.
Thank you very much. So it's a great pleasure to introduce Craig Kaplan to you tonight. Craig got his PhD from the University of Washington in 2002, studying under David Salison, and he's now a professor of computer science at the University of Waterloo in Ontario. He studies computer graphics, art, ornamentation, and especially the history of mathematics in art. He is the author of the textbook about tiling theory and computer graphics. And as of the start of this year, he is the editor of the Journal of Mathematics and Art. Craig Kaplan.
Well, thanks very much for coming. Thanks very much to the museum, to George and Glenn, and everyone else here for inviting me. It's great to be here. And thanks to Scott for introducing me. Scott is the author, as Glenn said, of the Electric Sheep screensaver, which is by far the coolest screensaver you will have ever seen. So cool that you can wear it on your T-shirt if you're Scott and you know, and other people as well. So you should all go and look at it and download and play with it. It's really great. But that's not what I'm here to talk about, much as I would like to. But I'm happy to talk about this slice of math and art as well. So I'm a professor of computer science. I'm interested in the intersections between mathematics and art. And I want to talk to you a little bit about what that intersection looks like. In particular, looking at one style of mathematical art that has been the focus of my study for many years, among other topics, Islamic art and Islamic star patterns. So I'll talk a little bit about the history, where this stuff comes from, and then show you some of the ways that modern conceptions of mathematics, things that we have discovered in mathematics since these designs were originally created, can help us revolutionize the field of design as well. So that's where I'm going with this. I mean, design is a huge topic, so is mathematics, and so is the intersection, as a matter of fact, so there's only so much I can say on any of those areas, but I'll do my best to show you some interesting stuff related to Islamic art. So first, where does this stuff come from? I mean, mathematics and art are both very old, thousands and thousands of years old. In fact, the practice of design, the practice of decorating surfaces with geometric patterns, very easily predates written history. So in fact, we don't know when exactly this practice got going, but we know there are certainly Neolithic examples of geometric designs inscribed on works of human craftsmanship, things that were clearly made by people. And it's definitely ornamentation because these things don't serve any practical purpose as decorations, right? So we know that we were creating decorations for the sake of decoration. Here's another great example. These carved stone balls, which can be found throughout the UK, clearly have the geometry of the Platonic solids at heart, the cube and the tetrahedron and the octahedron. Although we're talking about roughly 2000 BC, we're talking about 1500 years before Plato. So there's clearly a sense in which we had an intuitive understanding of these mathematical structures before we ever tried to codify what we were doing. And it's kind of mathematics that came in later and tried to create the rules to understand what we were already doing intuitively. Kind of an interesting fact. Now, the point at which it could be said we finally set the rules down in writing was the time of Euclid's Elements. The Elements were composed, if I remember correctly, around 400 to 300 BC. This is an early example of a surviving papyrus that has a fragment of the Elements written on it. So originally written in Greek, not invented by Euclid. Euclid more compiled the Elements than he did invent all the theorems in them. A lot of the stuff had been known previously. But he set it all down and created, in a sense, the first mathematical revolution, which is the invention of rigor, the invention of what it means for something to be known to be true in mathematics. How do we know that we know something? That was the idea of proof that came out of the Elements. The Elements has an interesting history. It was translated widely, I mean originally written in Greek, but translated into Latin early on, around the 6th century, but then really lost to the West. The West didn't really have much going on around the second part of the first millennium. On the other hand, the practice of mathematics and geometry flourished in the East, in the Arab world, and you can see that it was really when it was translated into Arabic around the 9th century that people started practicing the geometry of the elements in a regular way. And so here's a 13th century translation of the elements, but it had been done earlier. And in fact, it's only because of the Arabic translations that the elements eventually found their way back into Western Europe. A British monk, or was it a Welsh monk? I guess British. Abelard of Bath, who traveled to the East and created a Latin translation from the Arabic translation, brought it back to the West. And that's really where the elements comes from in our modern mathematics. Now, I said that the Arabic scholars were really masters of this kind of mathematical practice, and you can see that reflected in the art of the time. So if we look at some of the great monuments of Islamic art, you can see that there's a very strong sense of geometry, a clear mastery of geometry. And in fact, Islamic art can be broken down into broadly into a few main categories, and they're well represented in these two pictures. On the left, you can see on the top, there's a dome that starts. You can't see all of the dome. But the dome is decorated with stylized floral motifs that are repeated in patterns. There's a central band there that's calligraphy, and it's really in the Islamic world and also to some extent in China that the calligraphic arts reach their peak. There's also a little bit more calligraphy on the main face of the building there, but it's much more geometric, so there's also a very rigid structure that was used for calligraphy as well. That's sometimes called square kufic, or sometimes shatranji kufic, which is the word for chessboard, if I remember correctly. And of course, there are also Islamic star patterns, which are these geometric arrangements of lines that feature a lot of stars. And that's the example on the right is meant to typify that. You can see there's a large star in the middle of that design, and I'm going to talk a lot about how to construct these kinds of patterns. Now, it seems like there's not a lot of representation in Islamic art. What's clearly not visible in these examples are things like pictures of people and animals. And there are theories as to why Islamic culture did not use a lot of representation of people and animals. The most common theory is just that there's an explicit prohibition on direct representation in the religion, in Islam. And there are some reasons why you might suppose that prohibition is there. It's not quite right. That's not quite true. I mean, for example, there's a long-standing tradition in Persian art of miniature portraiture. So here's a painting of people. But certainly in a religious context, you're much less likely to see direct representation. So there is a reason why geometric art might have flourished in this context, because they wanted to represent, in a way, through geometry, the notion of perfection and the kind of religious exaltation that can only come from a beautiful mathematical design. Of course, Islamic art can be found throughout a huge part of the world. A big part of the world was under Islamic rule for centuries, stretching all the way to Western Europe, which is why you'll find the beautiful Alhambra Palace in southern Spain, across Europe, Northern Africa, Middle East, Indian subcontinent, across into Asia. So you can find these designs in a huge part of the world. There's also, in a way, separate decorative traditions according to regions. So there's a separate tradition that's popular in Morocco based on arrangements of small tiles, sometimes called zilij tiles. Usually, clustered around a large central star. So I think the design on the right there has a star with 24 points. These can get quite intricate. This design, I believe, has a central star with 96 points, which is an amazing piece of geometry. And, you know, this is not done the easy way. This is not painted on or stenciled or inkjet printed or something like that. It's much too old for that. In fact, this design is made out of thousands of individual terracotta glazed tiles that have been cut by hand by craftsmen. So it's an amazing achievement, and these things can be found all over Morocco. Now, one of the amazing things from a mathematical point of view, one of the great things about these designs is that they're a bit of a mathematical riddle. We don't really know how they were constructed originally. We don't have the full story on what the magic construction techniques were that would let me come up with this design, or any of the others. We have some hints, but for the most part, you know, it's pretty much these were trade secrets. They were passed through individual to individual as secret techniques, right? So we don't have the magic manual that explains how to construct these designs. But like I said, we do have some hints. This is one example, a famous document called the Topkapi Scroll from Turkey. It's a little bit washed out, unfortunately, but what you're looking at is some examples of star patterns with additional lines that give some sense of how they might have been constructed. So there's a little bit more detail there that you're not seeing in my slide. In fact, there's more. There are also, if you look very closely at the original document, which I haven't, but I'm told, You can even see that there are faint scribe lines, which were not drawn in, but just traced into the paper with a sharp point to give additional construction lines. So there's some information there that gives us hints as to what these original artisans were thinking when they created these designs. And over time, mathematicians have examined these and tried to understand what the technique would be, or what a plausible technique would be to construct star patterns. Because, you know, we can't just admire the patterns. We want to know where they come from and how can we create them. From a computer science point of view, of course, I want to call that reverse engineering. I want to reverse engineer a construction method that I can then use as a computer scientist to create new designs. So here's one proposed technique that has a fair amount of momentum. You know, people generally agree that it's one way that people constructed star patterns, although definitely not the only way. And it's called the polygons in contact technique. This name comes from a person named Hankin, who was a member of the Archaeological Survey of India and wrote a series of papers in the 20s and 30s where he presented his evidence for this technique and a few examples of constructions based on it. So we start with some, let me work backwards from an existing pattern. So I take a pattern like this, which obviously has a lot of extra detail in it that does not really play a role in the mathematical structure. So the first thing I do as a mathematician is I focus on the abstract geometric pattern by taking away all of the floral design and reducing the pattern down to a sequence of lines, which, of course, is not to minimize the beauty of the floral design, only that I have to find something to start with. If you look at these lines, you can see that there are a lot of intersections, a lot of places where the lines intersect. And where they intersect, they form angles that are the same everywhere. So all of those intersections, except a few of them around the big central stars, all of those intersections have the same repeating angles. And so it seems like those intersections might somehow be the basis for constructing the pattern. And this turns out to work out very well. So if we in fact build a tiling based on the locations of those intersections, if I make a tile that joins up all of those intersections, it turns out that you can decompose this pattern in a clean way into a tiling of the plane that has a little fragment of the pattern, a single motif, inscribed in every tile. So if I want to know how to design an Islamic star pattern, it seems like all I need is a tiling with a few different shapes and a means of constructing a motif inside each unique shape. And as a computer scientist, I say, well, this is gold. I mean, this is great because this is a lot of repetition and a lot of boring calculations that I can automate, put in a computer program, and then explore this space in a very efficient and very productive way. So that's what I did as a computer scientist. I might as well jump right to I'll take the opportunity and also the risk of showing a live software demo. A simple demo of some software. Now, I can't see what I'm doing on my screen, so I have to. Actually, I'll just change it so I can see what I'm doing. That'll make life easier. All right, there. Now I can see what I'm doing. So let's start with a very simple tiling. This is about as simple as they get. It's the regular tiling by hexagons. And I will grow a pair of lines out of the center of every edge. And the only special rule I apply is when two lines meet, I'll stop growing them. So you can see that if I grow these lines out of the center of the edge, they meet, I stop, erase the tiling, and there's a very simple star pattern as an example. So this is a fairly simple piece of software that you can write from a computer science point of view. This is an exercise I give to my graduate students every time I teach this stuff. And then you have the great thing from a computer science point of view is that I now have a whole bunch of degrees of freedom that I can play with to explore this space of possible designs. So I can pick different tilings. I'll pick this one as an example. I've got my magic go button. And now one of the degrees of freedom is I can explore the angle that I make with the edges of the tiling. So I can just fiddle with that angle all I want, right, from 0 to 90 degrees. And as I do that, I get a range of different designs that you would say are aesthetically quite different from each other. You explore a range that even within this fixed tiling, visually, your eye locks onto different things for different angles. And there are a few other tricks here, like if I press the magic 2 checkbox, then I'm going to add, you can see I'm adding, it's a 2 button. You're adding a layer of geometry inside each of the stars. That corresponds a little bit to what I showed you on the slide, where there's extra geometry inside this octagon. So I play with the angle. Another nice trick you can play with is if I set the angle here to 45 degrees, and I can do this exactly because I give myself a keyboard command for it, then I can also drag the two contact positions away from each other. So instead of having both lines grow out of the center of an edge, I can have the lines grow out of two different places on the edge, and you get this interesting kind of chainmail linked ring. I know, it's like a magic show. Ta-da! I get these interesting linked rings that that form a nice design. Now, of course, once you've got that, so just a little bit more playing with software, and then I'll stop. Once you've got that, well, then you can apply a number of different decoration algorithms to it. So, you know, an obvious thing to do is to just thicken these into strips. Now, I didn't really do anything that special here. It looks more or less the same. But of course, understanding the geometry of these thickened bands is really great, because now I could, for example, instruct some kind of cutting tool to cut along all these lines, and what will be left will be a screen made out of this design. And of course, there are other traditional rendering styles that are important in Islamic art. One of the most important is interlacement, where you alternately, the bands will alternate going over and under the other bands they encounter. And you can prove, using some simple combinatoric arguments, that this is always possible. This is an interesting mathematical fact, that you never make one band go over and under and over and under, and the other one go over and under, and come to some band where the decisions have all been made, but it's inconsistent. You can no longer strictly alternate. As long as the lines in the design satisfy some basic mathematical properties, you can always strictly alternate, which is a nice induction proof, actually, for those of you who are into induction proofs. And you know, there's a few other simple rendering styles here that I won't go into. All right. So like I said, there's a bunch of different opportunities here. Here's another simple tiling. I'm only going to show this tiling here because it is foreshadowing for the activity we'll do at the end. So this tiling based on regular dodecagons and equilateral triangles, we'll play with this at the end of after the talk. All right. Oh, and I should mention, because I forgot to mention this in the earlier talk, but it seems silly not to. Software similar to this is available. I made it available on the web. I offered this as a Java applet that you can play with online, and in fact, someone else took that and made a more comprehensive tool that you can download if you search on the tool, which is called, I think it's on the next slide, which is called Taprats. So if you Google Taprats, you should be able to find it, or my name. So here's just a few of the other designs you can get using this technique. It's a very nice design space. It's a space of things where you can explore. And because we're doing this with computers, it's painless and effortless in the sense that if I don't like a design, I can just do something else. I can just move my dial somewhere else. Whereas if I was working 1,000 years ago, in order to draw enough of the design to appreciate whether it's good or not, I'd have to spend a week drawing all these lines and say, yeah, it's not, you know, it's all right, but it's not. And then I'd have to, like, I'm going to change the angle by 10 degrees and try again. That becomes a lot of work. All right, now, the one thing I didn't tell you about, I told you if I gave you a tiling, how can I get the motifs in those tiles? But I didn't tell you where these tilings come from. So I figured, because this is a mathematically inclined audience, I should talk a little bit about tilings. I happen to love tiling theory and its applications in design, so it's an opportune moment. So how can you construct tilings that would be useful for constructing Islamic star patterns? Well, let me show you a technique that works reasonably well. Now, ultimately, this technique is based on the mathematical theory called symmetry theory, which is all ultimately derived from group theory. I don't want to spend the time to introduce symmetry theory as a mathematical theory. So instead, I'll talk about it in terms of these regular tilings of the plane. And if you are a mathematician, you can map this onto symmetry theory in your head, hopefully. All right, so let's start by choosing a regular tiling of the plane. Now, this is easy because there are only three, so you only have to make a choice A, B, or C. That's good. You can prove that a regular tiling of the plane, which is defined as a tiling where every polygon is an identical regular polygon, all the side lengths are the same, all the angles are the same, and they meet, all the corners touch other corners. You don't have like a T-junction where a corner touches the middle of an edge. Well, you can prove there are only three such tilings. It's a nice little algebraic exercise. And they are triangles, squares, and regular hexagons. And in fact, I'm going to give these simple mathematical names, not because I just want to introduce notation for no reason, but because I'm going to generalize these names a little bit later. So it pays to introduce them now. So I call these, I give these simple names. The names are a description of what you see around a vertex. So if you look at a point where some tiles meet, in the triangle case, you have six equilateral triangles, six three-sided polygons meeting around every vertex. So I call that something like 333333, which I abbreviate as 3 to the power of 6, just to save space. The middle tiling has 4 squares meeting around every vertex, 4444. The right-hand tiling has 3 regular hexagons meeting around each vertex, 666, the tiling of the beast, of course. You can't not say that once you get there. All right, so we just choose one of those. And in fact, it's even easier, I should mention, it's even easier than this. If you study symmetry theory, you know that the symmetry groups of the left and right-hand tilings are identical. There's a single group that those are both taken from. If you don't know what that means, you don't have to worry about it. But it means really you only have to choose A or B. You don't have to choose A, B, or C. All right, and note the names because I'll come back to them later. Now, what I'm going to do is build a tiling by specifying tiles that will live inside the tiles of the regular tiling. So I choose one of those. I'm going to put a new tile inside each of those hexagons. And the only restriction is that that tile be compatible with the hexagon itself. And by compatible, I'm going to mean in this case that I choose a number of sides that is a multiple of the number of sides of the hexagon. And that guarantees that, like, I can orient it so that there's always an edge of the polygon I choose lining up with an edge of the hexagon. So all I really have to do is pick an integer m and multiply that by 6. That's what I'm doing here. Similarly, I can do a choice like that at every vertex. So at every vertex of this tiling, I'm going to choose a multiple. In this case, I'll choose 3. So I get 9-sided polygons around the vertices. And again, they're oriented so that the edges line up with the edges of the rest of the tiling. Of the other tiles, sorry. In theory, I could also optionally make a choice at the edge centers. You would recognize the edge centers as centers of twofold rotation if you are a mathematician. Otherwise, don't worry about it. And now the next step is I want to scale up these tiles so that they meet each other and consume all the space, well, or as much space as they can. So I want to scale up these 12-sided polygons, dodecagons, and the 9-sided polygons, enneagons, although some people say nonagons. It ought to be enneagons for consistency. Thank you very much. With apologies to They Might Be Giants, who have a great song called Nonagon, right, as some of you may know. All right, so we scale these up. Now, it's interesting because we have 2 unknowns, the sizes of the 2 polygons, and we have 2 equations. In this case, the 2 equations are going to be that I want the polygons to meet, I want those edges to touch, and I want the side lengths to be the same. So a nice bit of math, 2 equations and 2 unknowns. You plug in a whole bunch of trigonometry, and if you love trigonometry as much as I do, then you spend some time fiddling with it on paper and solving the equation. Although, full disclosure, as a computer scientist, I solved the equation, and then I threw it out and solved it by binary search numerically because that was easier. But, it's nice to do the trigonometry first anyway. All right, so we do the scaling, and you end up with the dodecagons and the enneagons meeting perfectly, edge to edge. And there's a little bit of leftover space, which I will simply fill up by introducing new tiles, bow tie shapes. That's fine. Those new tiles are still compatible with my method of growing lines out of the centers of edges. No problem. And this simple method of putting tiles down at these rotational centers and then scaling everything up and filling in the rest of the space, in fact, yields a whole diverse family of tilings that do correspond well to the kinds of designs that come up in Islamic art. So this is a lot of progress towards the problem. It doesn't solve it entirely, which is great. Human ingenuity will also always outpace what we can solve in a rigid way with mathematics. So if you go and explore the world of Islamic art, you will see many, many designs where the tilings cannot at all be explained using techniques like this. And that's great. There's always more to do. There's always more to look at. All right, now that I've got this, I want to play a couple of tricks with it, right? Here's a technique where I've got the tiling. I've got the means of filling each tile with a motif. What are some of the interesting tricks we can play to make novel designs that couldn't have been done earlier, couldn't have been done historically? Here's a first one that's fairly simple. If I have a technique that lets me vary the angle continuously, then I can vary it in a single design. Let me vary the angle continuously in space and assemble the pattern that way. So this is giving you a preview. You can see that each of those octagonal stars has a slightly different contact angle depending on where it is in the plane. I'm trying to give you a graph of that function at the bottom. And if I do that and actually draw the design, I get this really nice pattern on the top. I call this an Islamic parquet deformation. The term parquet deformation comes from a designer and architect named William Huff, who used to give this as an exercise to his design students at the University of Buffalo in the 60s and 70s. And so I'm adapting this to the world of Islamic art. I like the one at the top. As I said, as I dial up different angles, your eye locks into different features. And this has to do very much with the structure of your eye. You see, your eye prefers vertical and horizontal stuff and then diagonal stuff. And so, you know, there's no particular mathematical reason why certain angles would be different than others, but you're trained to see certain orientations and angles preferentially. And it's also, in some sense, evolved. So that's why you can almost see different bands of design that your eye locks onto in the top design. And the bottom one, similar idea, just colored in. And that one will make a cameo appearance later in the talk as well. All right. So here's another nice trick we can play. And this one deserves to be a full-fledged chapter of the talk because it really is a revolution in mathematics. By some accounts, the development of curved space, by which I mean, in this case, non-Euclidean geometry, is the revolution, not just in mathematics, but in all of science. Some people would argue this was one of the greatest revolutions in science. So I want to adapt the notion of design, and in particular star patterns, to a world where space is curved. In order to do that, let's start by going back to the beginning. Here's Euclid again. In particular, Euclid's Elements begins with a statement of five postulates. Well, it doesn't actually start 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It introduces the postulates as necessary, but eventually it gets to five of them and no more come in. So we have these five postulates where you have to accept these as given. What Euclid would say is, these are true, and if you accept them as true, as self-evident, then I can deliver to you a whole bunch of additional math that flows from it. You know, these are axioms, and all the rest of the math is theorems derived from those axioms via rules that we all agree on. Now, to be fair, mathematicians have cleaned this up a little bit over time. We've discovered that there were some hidden assumptions and unstated things in here. And finally, at the start of the 20th century, we finally wrote down things in a way that we believe is absolutely rock solid, unshakable. But that's, in a sense, another story. The thing I want to focus on here, and these are very loose. You know, don't try to write this down on your math test. This is not at all rigorous. But in particular, I do want to focus on that fifth one, the so-called parallel postulate, which says that parallel lines exist and are unique. Now, that is vague, so let me be a little bit more precise. Here's a statement of the parallel postulate called Playfair's postulate, which turns out to be equivalent to the parallel postulate. If you give me a line L and a point P that is not on L, then there is exactly one line that goes through P and never touches L, or is parallel to L. And that seems absolutely obvious. How could that not be true? Because, you know, if you consider all the lines through P, some of them are tilted a little bit to the left, so they have to intersect L on the left. Some of them are tilted a little bit on the right, so they intersect L on the right. And there's got to be exactly one line between the ones tilted to the left and the one tilted to the right. Right? No, wrong, right? That is your Euclidean bias speaking. That is based on your hidden assumptions about what a straight line ought to be, or what space ought to be. And although it is intuitively appealing, it is not necessarily true. Now, this bothered mathematicians for a long, long, long time. I mean, a thousand years plus. You know. And what really bothered mathematicians was that this fifth postulate was much more complicated than the other four. It didn't seem to have the same flavor. It didn't seem to have the sense of inevitability that drives elegance in mathematics. And it's a powerful force in the development of new mathematics, the sense of something being canonical. The great mathematician Erdős spoke of a proof from the book, that in heaven God has a book of all the perfect proofs of every theorem. And if a proof didn't have that flavor, he would say that it wasn't a proof from the book. But anyway, so mathematicians fought for centuries to try to show that the parallel postulate follows as a consequence of the other four. Tried to derive ways of saying that if the first four things are true, then the fifth one must also be true. And one of the great moments in history in this battle was achieved by Sacchieri, who was a Jesuit monk who also was a mathematics professor. And he wrote a book called, it has a Latin name which translates to English as Euclid Freed of Every Blemish, or Euclid Freed of Every Flaw, which is a lofty goal, where he sought to show that the parallel postulate followed from the other four postulates of Euclid. What he eventually arrived at was the following construction. He arrived at a diagram like the one on the upper right, where he drew a line segment AB, and then erected perpendicular lines, 90-degree angles, pointing upward from A and from B, and then completed the diagram by forming a quadrilateral. And then he asked, what are the angles at C and D? Now, if you're a Euclideanist, you say, well, this is a rectangle, so the angles have to be 90 degrees. But you can't know that to be true just from the diagram. The diagram is not the proof. So he said, well, there are three possibilities. The angle could be 90 degrees, or it could be more than 90 degrees, or it could be less than 90 degrees. And all I have to do is rule out the more than 90 and less than 90 cases. So it turns out the obtuse case, the more than 90 degree case, is easy to rule out. It follows quickly from the other four postulates. But the acute case was really hard. And Saccheri worked on it for pages and pages and pages and years and years and years and could not come to a satisfying resolution, could not rule out the acute case as a consequence of the first four postulates of Euclid. And finally, he arrived at the following statement in his book, translated into English: the hypothesis of the acute angle is absolutely false. You have to scream it. It should be in all caps, right? Because it is repugnant to the nature of the straight line. This is called proof by intimidation, but the lens of history is not kind to intimidation, I guess, unfortunately. What is the problem here? Where did Saccheri go wrong? In a way, Saccheri went wrong because somewhere in the back of his mind was something telling him that the straight line had a nature, that there was an intrinsic nature to the straight line that he had to follow. But mathematics doesn't work that way. You don't get to make assumptions and not write them down. If the straight line has a nature, then that has to be a postulate. And in a way, the fact, the impossibility of the acute angle is nothing more than another statement of the parallel postulate in disguise. It is a statement about the nature of the straight line. So it took a while, but mathematicians eventually figured out that you do not have to accept the parallel postulate. You can accept alternate versions of the parallel postulate that, as written, are self-consistent with the other postulates of Euclid. And in particular, the revolution came in the early part, the first half of the 19th century, 1830s, 1820s, contemporaneously by a couple of mathematicians, Janos Bolyai in Hungary and, I know his name, Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky is his name, as some of you will know, right, from Russia. That was his name, I believe. In fact, it's an interesting story, again, from mathematical history. Bolyai's father, who was also a mathematician, was so excited by Janos Bolyai's discovery of non-Euclidean geometry, in which parallel lines exist but are not necessarily unique. I'll show you that in a second. He was so excited by the discovery that he wrote to Gauss, who was the greatest mathematician of the age, or possibly of any age, and said, look what we discovered. It's non-Euclidean geometry. I guess they didn't call it that. And Gauss had his usual Gaussian response, which is something like, well, to praise this work would be nothing but to praise myself, for I discovered the same thing 20 years ago, only I didn't tell anyone because I didn't think the world was ready. I mean, he really did. He said something very much like that. To his credit, he was right. He really had done this work a few years before and not told anybody. But the credit really still often goes to Bolyai and Lobachevsky, which is great. Now, how can this possibly work? How can you have multiple parallel lines through a point? A line L and a point P and multiple lines through P that are all parallel to L. Well, it can't work in our usual conception of geometry, but we can invent alternate universes of geometry in which we can make it work. So here is a view of an alternate world, an alternate plane in which I assert that we can have multiple parallel lines through a point. Now, this is clearly distorted. Those circular arcs you see made out of the edges of black and white triangles, those are straight lines in this world. And you might say, well, I've got you because those actually aren't straight, they're circular. And I say, wow, I didn't notice that. No, I did notice that. This is a model of geometry in which straight lines are represented by curved lines, and that's okay. If you want to think about it as a model, then that's great. If you don't want to think about it as a model, you could just think about this as a view of a world through a distorted lens. That somewhere out there, there's a world with straight lines. If you lived in this world, those lines would look straight. But it's like we're looking at it through a funny fisheye lens. The difference is that if I look at the real world through a fisheye lens, I can also undo the fisheye effect and make everything nice and flat and straight. This world cannot be laid out flat in our Euclidean piece of paper. Oh, well, that's okay. Now, here's a visualization of Playfair's postulate in the non-Euclidean plane. There's my line L, which happens to be a diameter of the circle in this case. And there's my point P. And you can see that both of those red lines are straight lines, both of which are parallel to L. Don't touch L anywhere. You know, there's a lot more math involved to convince yourself that this all works, but that's okay. It does work, and this is a self-consistent view of geometry in which all of Euclid holds, including this negated version of the parallel postulate. What's really important here, from my point of view, is that this opens up incredible opportunities for new design. So one of the first and most important people to observe the artistic implications of hyperbolic geometry, of course, was Escher, who one of the quests throughout his life in creating geometric art was the attempt to represent infinity in a finite space. Because, he could never actually produce an infinitely large drawing of lizards or fish or what have you. He wanted to capture the notion of infinity in a finite space. And he tried a bunch of approaches over the years. Nothing was ever really entirely satisfying until he saw a diagram like this one in a math textbook by Coxeter. Coxeter is one of the great geometers, mathematicians of the 20th century, born in Britain, but did most of his work at the University of Toronto, which is not far from where I am in Waterloo. So Escher saw some designs in Coxeter's book, was not a mathematician, was never had any mathematical training, but had such a profound mathematical intuition that he was able, just by sort of transcribing the lines from those patterns, was able to come up with some designs like this. Now, these are not Escher originals. These are artist renditions of Escher's originals by a computer scientist named Doug Dunham from Minnesota, which is both a good, it's a good plug for Doug, I guess. Go, Doug. Doug was one of the first people, maybe the first person, I think, to show how to use computer graphics to draw hyperbolic patterns. And he has spent a long time doing wonderful work creating hyperbolic ornamental design. I should mention, by the way, so I talked about non-Euclidean geometry being hyperbolic geometry. That's what we call it. I can also say, well, what about the other negation? You know, the original parallel postulate said parallels exist and are unique. And then I negated that by saying parallels exist and are not unique. I could have potentially said parallels do not exist at all. That if I have a point P not on a line L, then every line through P must intersect L. And in fact, with a little bit of fiddling, because this doesn't work exactly as written for reasons I won't go into, with a little bit of fiddling, you arrive at a description of the geometry on the surface of a sphere, spherical geometry. And I mention that here because I want to unify. I want to do design in a unified world of Euclidean, hyperbolic, and spherical geometry. I'll show you how to do that. What's great here is that the construction technique I showed you for Islamic star patterns works equally well in Euclidean and non-Euclidean geometry. Ultimately, from a mathematical point of view, as long as I treat the parallel postulate as off-limits when I describe a construction, a geometric construction, as long as my construction is based purely on the first four postulates of Euclid, then it ought to work seamlessly in Euclidean and non-Euclidean geometry, because it is only the invocation of the parallel postulate that restricts you to one or the other. Okay, so here are my regular tilings again. Recall. Now, are there regular tilings in non-Euclidean geometry? Well, definitely. And in fact, you're already familiar with a lot of them. Here are five that you already know well. In spherical geometry, the regular tilings of the spherical plane, the surface of a sphere, correspond exactly with the Platonic solids. So now, they don't look exactly like this. What I actually have to do is inflate them so that they turn into spheres. So they look like that. So the regular tilings of the sphere are, for example, regular spherical pentagons meeting three around every vertex instead of hexagons, for example. It's interesting, actually, because you're more constrained when you work in non-Euclidean geometry. So the regular tiling by hexagons, I can make bigger hexagons, smaller hexagons, any size hexagon I want. When I say I want the regular tiling by pentagons meeting three around a vertex, the pentagons have to be exactly one particular size so that they fit around the sphere exactly. Interesting fact. Now, so I have my five regular tilings of the sphere, and it looks like I've got a trend going here. 3 to the 3, 3 to the 4, 3 to the 5 along, you know, the x-axis. The exponent is growing along the x-axis, and the lower number, the abscissa? Oh, I should have looked it up. Ah, Wikipedia. All right. The first number is growing as I go up the y-axis. So can I fill this table in with more tilings? Well, definitely, right? The Euclidean tilings fit nicely in this diagram. 4-4 fits right there, right? And if I went along on the bottom row, I would hit triangles next. If I went along the first column, hexagons would be next. And I can complete the table out to infinity in every direction, well, at least to the right and up, by filling in everything else with hyperbolic tilings. Hyperbolic regular tilings of the plane. Again, they look distorted, although in the hyperbolic world, every polygon in one of those tilings is identical to every other one. They are the same shape. They look distorted, but from a design point of view, aesthetically, that's not necessarily a bad thing, as long as they are somehow analogous. They don't have to be exactly congruent. All right, so let me adapt my construction technique to non-Euclidean geometry. On the left is the Euclidean tiling with dodecagons and enneagons. I can make a very similar, closely related tiling by instead of putting 12-sided regular polygons, I put 10-sided regular polygons. Or rather, I move from the regular tiling 6 to the 3 to the regular tiling 5 to the 3. Another way of looking at it is, in order to turn those 12-sided polygons into 10-sided polygons, I have to take a wedge out of each polygon, remove a little bit of space from every point in the plane. And when I do that, the plane kind of collapses on itself and turns into a ball. It's a very, very loose description of what's going on. And conversely, if I want to turn those 12-sided polygons into 14-sided polygons, I add a little bit of space around every point. And when I add a little bit of space, the plane kind of opens up and turns into the hyperbolic plane. For a lot more on this, see the following Math Encounters talk by Jeff Weeks, The Shape of Space. All right, little plug there. All right, so and once I have these tilings, I can put my motifs inside the tiles to get analogous star patterns in the plane, the sphere, and the hyperbolic plane. So some simple examples of that was, fun trying to come up with. So this is some research I did a few years ago, trying to come up with like analogous designs between Euclidean and non-Euclidean geometry. And one nice thing about this work from a computer science point of view, if there are computer scientists in the room, is that you can write the code in an abstract layer that is independent of the kind of geometry you use. So you kind of plug in the geometry later, and it adapts itself and constructs the same pattern no matter what curvature of space you pass in. All right, so there's another one done with embossing. This one is it's a little bit hard to see, unfortunately, with this projector, but it's interlaced. And in fact, this is the same design that's on the poster for the talk. Here's something that I just added about an hour ago. I couldn't resist, so the earlier talk did not get to see it. Thank you for coming. There are other ways to curve space. I'm not going to say anything about the mathematical technique, but we can also talk about conformal geometry, where you can take a Euclidean design. So this is actually a flat Euclidean design that has kind of been wrapped into a funny shape and bent around, but it's still fundamentally Euclidean in a way that hyperbolic design is not. And you can get these really interesting swirling spiral vortices of tiles and adapt that and use Islamic star patterns in that context for nice effects. So these are actually this one I made only, I guess, 2 or 3 weeks ago. I just wanted to see if it would work out, and it did. It's kind of neat. With these two vanishing points, these two kind of centers where things recede, diminish down to zero, and there are sort of infinitely many tiles collected around those two points. Now, those are all places where we curve. What about bunnies? Yeah, I mean, I knew someone was going to ask, but what about bunnies? I mean, you haven't talked about bunnies yet. Those are all spaces where the curvature is the same everywhere. The sphere has the same curvature everywhere. It's always like the same amount of extra or deficient space around every point. But an arbitrary surface, a manifold, as we would say, can have different curvatures in different points. Some places might be more like convex, more spherical, and some places might have more space around every point, we say saddle-shaped. And when you generalize in that way, you arrive roughly at Riemannian geometry, where we measure distances locally. We don't have a preconception about what straight lines are at all. We sort of let the straight line be dictated by what the surface is doing at some point. And in fact, Riemannian geometry eventually gave way to the idea of curved space, or space-time. In other words, Riemannian geometry is one of the most important first steps in getting to Einstein's theory of relativity. I'm not going to need quite that much mathematical sophistication here. All I need is a bunny with some squares on him, or rather roughly squares. The bunny is subdivided into these quadrilaterals that can roughly be mapped onto squares. So if I take a square piece of design and map it into each of these quadrilaterals, I can make a design on the surface of a bunny. Show you how that's done. So here's a sample pattern. This comes from an Escher drawing. And I carve out a square that causes this pattern to repeat. And sure enough, if I just tile the plane with those squares, I can make the pattern repeat as much as I want. But I can also glue that square onto each of the squares on the bunny surface, and I can cover the bunny with this seashell pattern. And you know, carrying this idea further, I can have Islamic star bunnies. And the design on the right is a traditional Egyptian ornamental pattern. And there's my tiling my Islamic star pattern with linked chainmail rings. And the one on the right is a Persian porcelain design. You might ask, does this only work for bunnies? Yes. No. This is where computer graphics enters the picture. This relies on very sophisticated algorithms that I did not implement, so I was forced to rely on the data sets provided by other people who had done the very complicated academic work to be able to divide this bunny into squares in a clean way. I don't know how to do that. It's a technique called mesh parameterization. So I just begged people to give me their parameterized meshes, and it turns out that one 3D model that is used all over the place in computer graphics research is this bunny. It's just a historical accident. Someone at Stanford decades ago, was it at Stanford? Yeah, Stanford bunny. Someone at Stanford decades ago had this little statue, a little garden ornament of a rabbit, and had an early 3D scanner and made a 3D scan of the rabbit, and it's been used ever since in computer graphics. Okay, another topic that I want to get to, order and chaos. In particular, I want to say a little bit about aperiodic tilings, because that's a great topic in mathematics and tiling theory. I better say, in order to tell you what an aperiodic tiling is, I better tell you what a periodic tiling is. So a translational symmetry of really any design in the plane, but a tiling in particular, is any time that you can pick up the tiling, slide it without turning it or flipping it over, and lay it down exactly on top of itself. Example? Yes, that's in a good. That's a translational symmetry of the tiling. And obviously, there are lots of ways that I can do this. I don't have to just slide that way. I can slide along really any arrow that brings me from a point in the tiling to sort of an analogous point somewhere else. There's a whole family of these. And any tiling that has all of these translational symmetries is called periodic. It's something that repeats in both directions in the plane. A tiling that is not periodic is called non-periodic. It's a good name. It just means that you don't have these symmetries. And of course, there are lots and lots of non-periodic tilings. If I just squiggle lines any which way, then the tiles I get are all different, so there's no periodicity. But even if I have a very regular tiling made out of a lot of identical shapes, it's very easy to make tilings that are not periodic. You know, for example, here's this 2x1 domino. Turn two of them sideways, no periodic symmetry anymore at all. These two tiles just like reneged and spoiled it for everyone else. On the other hand, this is kind of boring, right? Because I can easily rearrange these tiles to make a periodic tiling. So it seems like there's nothing really mathematically deep there. And yet, you know, we've heard of the phrase aperiodic tilings. There's got to be something going on that's more interesting than that. So sure enough, you know, the most famous aperiodic tilings are undoubtedly the Penrose tilings, the kite and the dart on the left, and also the thin and thick rhombs on the right. Now, these also have the property, as drawn, that I can rearrange the tiles to make periodic tilings. For example, I can take the rhombuses and make them into hexagons and then arrange those into a periodic tiling. So there's more information that you have usually not been told about what makes the Penrose tiling special. That's something that it's my public service to inform you about that. The tiles have these hidden matching conditions, these rules on the edges that force them only to fit together certain ways. And it's only with the addition of those matching conditions that the real magic happens. Because with these matching conditions, you can't make a tiling like that one or any other one that is periodic. And that's an amazing mathematical fact. You can prove that those little nooks and hooks and stuff are enough to force you to only tile in interesting ways. So aperiodicity, when I talk about an aperiodic tiling, I'm talking about a minimum level of complexity that the tiling not only can you make non-periodic tilings, but you can't avoid making them. That's what makes aperiodic tilings interesting. So what does this have to do with star patterns? Well, clearly I want to adapt the construction of star patterns to this context. Now, it doesn't look like I have any regular polygons here to put motifs inside of, but I do have vertices that look really promising, because although the lines do not emanate from the vertices at multiples of the same, at all regular angles, I have thin and thick gaps between lines, all the gaps are at multiples of 36 degrees. maybe that's a little hard to see well. Here's a visualization of that. You can see that where the lines occur, they do line up with my red lines at multiples of 36 degrees. And so it turns out that I can put my regular polygons around those vertices as well and put the motifs in there, and that'll work out. What does that look like in practice? Well, there's my thick Penrose ROM. I'll put regular 10-sided polygons around every vertex, like I did in the previous picture. I'll put my Islamic motif, my star motif, inside every polygon. I've still got that bow tie shape in the middle. That's no problem. I can fill that in with a little bit more geometry. There's my motif for this rhombus, for this ROM. And I'm going to use that everywhere I put a thick Penrose ROM. The thin ROM's a little more tricky because the decagons overlap. But that's okay. With a little bit of playing around by hand, I can come up with a motif that works reasonably well, right? The lines look okay. And if I lay the thin and thick rhombuses out in the arrangement of the Penrose tiling, then I can get this aperiodic Islamic star pattern. Or maybe it's better to call it a non-periodic pattern because the aperiodicity is kind of a secondary fact at this point. At any rate, it's not clear that aesthetically you can see the difference between non-periodicity and aperiodicity, right? Once things are arranged in this interesting quasi-regular order, that might be enough aesthetically. So here are a couple of other finished examples based on aperiodic tilings of different orders. It's the Penrose tiling. The Penrose ROMs are actually part of an infinite family of rhombic aperiodic tilings of different sizes. There's also this other more recent family of tiles that can be arranged to give patterns at multiple scales simultaneously. So now we have a different kind of order. We have a self-similar kind of order, the way that fractals are self-similar, the way that I can zoom in on a fractal and get something that looks the same as what I had when I started. And this kind of self-similarity occurs from time to time in Islamic design, and it's a really interesting phenomenon. You can see there's kind of two levels of order here. This was from a paper published in Science by Peter Liu and Paul Steinhardt a couple of years ago. Steinhardt is the physicist who coined the term quasi-crystal, which turns out to be the physical objects that have this kind of arrangement, this kind of symmetry. And in fact, Schechtman, who's the person who discovered that quasi-crystals do exist in nature, received the Nobel Prize for Physics in 2011. And going even further, there was an interesting article published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences very recently that was just written up. I saw an article in BBC yesterday that talked about how, after many years, it used to be that quasi-crystals were only synthesized, that we knew of no natural deposits of quasi-crystals in the world. But a mineral deposit was found in Russia that actually had quasi-crystals in it. And a little bit more study seems to indicate that it did not come from Earth, that it's extraterrestrial in origin, in the non-threatening way, that it just came in on a meteor, right? It's not like, right, it's not actually from extraterrestrials. But it's very interesting, I mean, that somehow it formed naturally in a meteor and came to Earth. Here's another multi-level design, just to show you some of this other self-similar order. You can see that there's a small-scale design that interlaces, and there's a larger-scale design traced out in black in the spaces inside the small-scale design. It's a beautiful thing by an architectural ornamentalist named Jay Bonner. One more topic I want to get to, not so much a revolution in mathematics as a revolution in technology, but one that is so much fun and so exciting I can't resist telling you about it, and that is the ability to take computer-generated designs and turn them into real-world artifacts. That's a great thing. So there are all kinds of devices now, pieces of technology, that can go directly from your computer design to a real-world thing. It used to be that you could look at it on the screen and say, well, that's great, but that's it. Or, you know, now give it to somebody who has to carve it out by hand, which, of course, takes a long time. Which is, you know, craftsmen, there's still a place for craftsmanship in the modern world, if anything, more than ever. But it's also great that we can prototype our designs efficiently with technology. So these were constructed using a computer-controlled laser cutter. A laser is is controlled by a robot arm that moves around and cuts through materials like paper and wood and other thin materials. And so all I have to do is create the design of the computer and then press go, and I get this when I'm done. These were constructed using a larger, more sophisticated machine called a water jet cutter. And this is just a bunch of samples that were cut with a water jet. A water jet is a high-pressure stream of water, 55,000 psi was the last time I looked. And the water is impregnated with garnet dust to make it highly abrasive, highly gritty. And these machines can cut through just about anything. up to like solid steel, like half-inch steel, inch-thick steel. It's amazing stuff. And it can also cut through glass and stone and other construction materials. So these were all prototypes for a house. So they feature all over the house. It's very cool. Here's a smaller scale design that I did directly. Here, it's a drill bit that's being controlled by the computer, and I use the drill bit to carve out the design from a block of linoleum, and then use that to do simple linoleum block lino-cut printing. And this is fun because this is both the computer-controlled technology, but with the handmade aspect to it as well. A couple more pieces, just for fun. These are some designs that I showed at SIGGRAPH, which is a big computer graphics conference, the big computer graphics conference held in the U.S. every year. Ooh, except it was in Canada last year. Excellent. For the first time ever in Vancouver, Canada. So you can see there are a few designs there. There are two designs, like the one on the right, that are cut out of corian, which is an industrial synthetic marble that's used for like countertops, and that was cut out with a laser. The one on the left was cut out of paper using a computer-controlled knife cutter, which is great because that's a very small, affordable tabletop tool. They're used for things like scrapbooking, so they're meant to be only a couple hundred dollars, so just about anybody can get one, and they're a lot of fun for experimentation. And of course, also, there's the other frontier is 3D printing, where you can construct, you take a 3D model in the computer and build it directly as a 3D physical object using incredibly cool printing technology. There's my bunny again, of course, making another appearance. So there's the Islamic Star Bunny, made out of ABS plastic using a 3D printing process. And the Museum of Mathematics is going to do really cool things with 3D printing, so stay tuned for that. Here are a couple of these Islamic star balls. The spherical design is a really good medium in which to play around with 3D printing, obviously. And there's one more done in a similar. This one's much more recent, though. This one was done using a website called shapeways.com, which I can recommend to all of you, where anybody who can create a 3D model can upload it and then order it in any number of different materials, including like plastic, glass, metal, food-grade ceramic, so you can make your own coffee mugs and such. And it's just a huge amount of fun. And of course, 3D modeling itself is becoming more accessible as well with tools like Google SketchUp. So everybody now has the opportunity to construct their own 3D models and then receive a package in the mail with something like this in it. Or if you don't want to construct 3D models of your own, you can just order this from Shapeways and then I get a little cut. All right, but that's enough of that. All right, so it remains for me just to wrap up. I mean, I of course have to put in the plugs for the organizations I'm involved with. So if you are interested in the intersection of art and mathematics, well, of course, keep coming to these talks and be a patron of the Museum of Mathematics. But if that's not enough, then I can also recommend, as Scott said at the start, I've taken over as editor of the Journal of Mathematics and the Arts, which is a scholarly journal published by Taylor and Francis in the UK. And I will be taking over after 5 years by Gary Greenfield. So we've already pretty well established, and it's put out quarterly. And of course, we welcome your submissions of academic papers. I'm also involved, as is George Hart, in the organization of the Bridges Conference, which is an annual conference on art and mathematics. This is a photograph of the group Zoom tool construction, where we built a giant sculpture out of this plastic geometric construction toy. I think this one had about 60,000 parts in it. And that was at this past year's conference in Coimbra, Portugal. This year's conference is in Towson, which is in Baltimore, Towson University in Baltimore, Maryland, in last week of July.